mean, I'm gonna walk you in. I'm not gonna run you in. I'm gonna walk you in.
Oh, dream.
I'm gonna walk you on the set. Yeah, I'm gonna walk you in.
Weave of magic.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls,
make this dream.
Players, playettes from all sides
tonight.
Of the globe. Yeah, the dream maker's here.
Dream maker.
He's here, the dream maker. The dream maker's here. Dream maker, make my dreams come true tonight. To the highest heights. For those unaware, if you don't know, you won't know, you inside the GGN with your host with the most, Finding Nemo, a.k.a. Nemo Hoes, and I got a very special guest in my seat tonight, the one and only, Arsenio Hall!
If I had the money, that would be my announcement. I'll be damn you held that old. Hey, you know what? You know where that came from? There was a guy in the hallways at Fox, and he had been the announcer for the Joan Rivers show. And I walked past him as I'm coming towards him. He said, "Arsenio," and he shook my hand, continued it, walked past me, and continued it until he disappeared around the corner. And I said, I was like, "Who was that nigga?" And they said, because it looked like one of the DeBarges or some shit. I was like, is James DeBarge out of jail? Who held that? Oh, who was that nigga? And they said, his name is Clint Holmes. And I remember from childhood, my name is Michael, I got a nickel.
Hey.
That's who, and he's a singer, so he has that circular breathing technique, and that's how you can hold that shit. But it was singer Clint Holmes, and he did that. I went and found him and said, "Would you be my announcer?" And that was my first announcer, holding that O like Snoop did, because he got two O's in his name, and he know the O.
Dope. That's too dope right there, man.
You know how long I've known this brother?
When I was a puppy, right?
Yes, indeed.
You know, my first national television debut was on your show.
Yes, yes, and
I ain't know how to talk or nothing.
I remember the phone call from Dre, and this is how long ago it was. Dre said to me, "I want you to meet Calvin and hear him flow."
Mm.
Calvin.
Who is that?
From Long Beach. And you know what's interesting about fame and stardom? This gentleman, as a young man, said to me when I first met him, he said, "I don't know about this stardom thing, because I'm respected on the streets, and I don't want to get famous and lose the respect I got on the street." That was interesting. I'd never heard anybody, because I was like, fuck the streets of Cleveland. I'm on my way to Hollywood, you know?
Yeah.
And he cared about who he was and the respect that he had in Long Beach.
Yeah, you were the platformer at that time. You were the only show that allowed people like myself to come on and be myself and not have to follow the guidelines of the Carson show or the regular shows that were on. You broke the mold, and you actually created this show that we're doing right here, because a lot of people feel like this is the Arsenio Hall Show, because guests come on my show and they're able to be comfortable. They don't feel trapped. They don't feel pressure. And they just come on here and just, they do what they want to do, like when we did when we was on your show.
You would sit on my couch and look at America and say, "I don't love them hoes." and the lexicon had been redesigned from that moment on.
Yes, sir.
I remember asking you to freestyle. And there was a time when I knew that was the way to tell the real
from the
real
fake.
Men from the fake.
Mm.
And I remember a hockey jersey, and you said, "Get them up, put them up." Ooh,
you took me to commercial. You wouldn't even let me go no more. You're like, "Get out of here."
Yes, yes, yes.
And man, then you were the first person that Lil Bow Wow did an interview with, and you allowed him to bust a freestyle on your show.
Yeah, I remember sitting in my office, and the security guard at Melrose Gate at Paramount said, Suge Knight is here with a small child. And the first thing,
you know, what to think.
Yeah, because I'm like, did I impregnate Suge's niece and he bringing me the baby and an ass whipping? I didn't know what to expect, you know? The guard tell you Suge Knight and a child is at the Melrose Gate. And I'm like, oh, we're getting fucked up. It can't be nothing else but an ass whipping. What can it be? You know, it's Suge and a child. What the fuck now? Oh, bitch didn't tell me she was related to Suge Knight. I don't love these hoes.
And we always look back at how, like, that's destiny for us, to be on a show as big as yours and as young as we was and as immature as we was in the music industry, to say that that was our start. I mean, you gave us our start. Because once I got on that show, the whole world knew who I was. But what's going on with you now? Because I heard that that thing is coming back.
Yes, indeed, man. Yes, indeed.
That thing, it's so overdue. I'm so glad it's back. Where is it going to be at? Talk to the people. Let them know where they
can
see it.
I'm going to start at 11 o'clock. Check your local listing. I'm on a station somewhere in your town. And all I ask is just on 9913, give me a shot and fuck with me. You know I got it.
9913, y'all know what that means. Realistically, we don't have a outlet to do what we do. That's why I created my show, because I felt like I was the next Arsenio Hall. I felt like I was the one who connected with everybody, who everybody felt comfortable with, talking to, expressing themselves. And I was able to hold a show that was mine, like how you had your show, and bring on guests that motherfuckers may not feel is appropriate, but fuck it, if they're appropriate in my world, that's what goes. Now look, I want to ask you about working on that movie, Coming to America.
Wow.
Because that movie right there is one of the top five greatest black movies of all time.
Thank you, man.
Like the creativity with the script, the writing it, the way y'all did it, y'all characters y'all play, you and Eddie being buddies, and just coming out here, just doing that shit. What was that like for you to do that movie?
Wow, it was incredible because, first of all, you're hanging out with your friend in New York working on something that's about to become history, and you don't know at that moment how it's going to work out. There were great times on the set. I remember sitting having lunch with James Earl Jones, you know, the most important voice on the planet. When you listen to CNN, when you listen to Darth Vader, you hear that voice, and when you're eating lunch and he says, pass me the salt. It's just iconic. You're like, shit. Right.
Yes, Darth Vader.
Yes.
Can I get you anything else?
Yes, indeed. And that was very cool. I remember that day at lunch, I had a scene after lunch with him where he was going to knock on the door of the Queen's apartment, and we didn't know he was in America, right? And I said, Mr. Jones, how should I play this scene? You know, I had the dialogue as to what I was supposed to say when I opened the door. And James Earl Jones was picking up his tray, and as he picked it up, he said, stand firm and tell the truth. And I was like, I don't know what that means, but that's some fly shit he just said. That's some fly shit. And he walked away, and I'm like, stand firm and tell the truth. And I thought about it, and I'm like, he just gave me an acting lesson. He's saying, find out what your truth is in that moment, and bring that through the dialogue and the scene and send that into the lens. And when he knocked on the door, I thought, he's supposed to be in Africa. Me and Akeem are fucked. And so I opened the door and said, ah! And slammed the motherfucker. That was my truth.
Yeah. Because you were shocked to see the motherfucker. Yeah. And wasn't no words that could explain your shock of seeing this motherfucker with a lion on his shoulder.
Yes.
At the front door.
Yeah. Yeah. You're supposed to be in Zamunda.
Nigga, you're supposed to be far, far away from here. So it is you, huh?
Hey, John Landis said, that's a take. Let's move on.
Motherfucking Harlem Nights. Nigga, you was so funny when they killed your brother when you was on Quick Ass.
Oh, yeah.
And that nigga with that little ass gun. Was that improv or was that scripted?
Yeah, now that was improv because the gentleman with the gun is deceased and his name was Eddie and he was a casting guy. But he basically wanted to do a scene. And we put him in that scene and we just played. It was late at night. You know, you're a little loopy. And at one point, guns, when you shoot them on the set, sometimes you augment the sound later in post and you make them louder and more menacing. But when he shot that gun, there was a point where I was like, the fuck is that little motherfucker? Because on set, it sounded like, you know, And I'm like, oh. So we just stopped playing with that.
That shit was so motherfucking funny.
I think the most important part about that movie for me is there were legends like Richard Pryor.
Yes.
And Della Reese.
Fox.
And Red Fox. And that was my opportunity to work with them. To know them is one thing, but to be able to share art with them is very, very special. And I want to see you act more because you got chops.
That's right. Well, you know, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, I told Eddie when we was working together, let's stop playing games and get it together and do something on the big screen. Mm-hmm. Because we did the big thing with the music thing. Now it's time for him to create another one of those movies where he could bring the best actors, like he always do, mm-hmm. and comedians and rappers together mm-hmm. to make some sort of masterpiece. Because that's what he did with Coming to America and Harlem Nights. He put the best of the best on screen that had never worked together before and made magic.
Go pick up Smooth. Thank you. This
oh,
month.
That's the magazine.
Yes.
Smooth,
please go pick it up.
32.
I'm not on page 32. It's issue number 30. My name is Hazel Renee. My name's on the cover. Just go pick that up, okay?
Magazines anymore.
It doesn't matter. People like the pictures. It's visuals. People just like the visuals.
You prefer the internet?
People like visuals. It's on the internet, too. Go to the internet. Actually, they sell it at Barnes & Noble and the newsstand right there on Beverly. And what is that, Wilshire? Yeah. Laurel Canyon in Ventura? Yeah. My hair's normally not like this, by the way. Sorry for the braids.
What's it only like?
Long and... If you go look at the magazine, you'll see that it's long. Actually,
you
it's
shut
like
up
down
about
here.
The goddamn magazine?
Well, then stop telling me what is my asking me. What does my hair look like? It's actually very bomb and pretty without the braids.
Anything else you want to say about the magazine?
Nothing else about the magazine. You asked about my hair. Hair is in the
yeah,
magazine.
Yeah,
hair is in the magazine. Hair is in the magazine.
Tell everybody how the show going to be different than it was before, or is it going to be the same?
You know what? I like to say it's going to look like I took a long, long-ass weekend mm-hmm. and came back and put myself into the pop-hop culture of today in the same way I was back then. There are people, like I mentioned, yourself and Mariah, who are still relevant. There are people like Alan Thicke, who has a son
Robin.
That's... you know, relevant. I remember a time when I used to work for Alan Thicke. Alan Thicke had a talk show, very much like this, and I was the guy who would say, Alan Thicke. I was his co-host and announcer. And sometimes I'd pop by his house the season that show was on, and there were two little boys that were always there. One had on a baseball cap most of the time, and he always had swagger, and you could see it. But the interesting thing is this kid would talk to me about my show. And he wouldn't ask me about Steve Garvey or something.
He asked about the niggas.
Yes! Yes!
So what was it like when you interviewed
yeah.
in WA when they came?
Absolutely. And he would say things to me that no white child has ever uttered. He would say, do you know Gerald Levert?
Like, nigga, how you know Gerald
yeah.
Levert?
Yeah, yeah. I'm like, Alan, is this your son? This, you know, this could be, you know, George Hamilton's kid. Because this kid got a dark sensibility about music.
Alan Thicke wrote Different Strokes.
Yes, Alan
which
Thicke.
Which is my favorite theme song of all time as a kid. The
world don't move to the beat of just one drum.
What may be right for you may not be right for some. A man is...
Oh, you know the whole motherfucking
song. That's my shit.
Everybody got one like that. Everybody got, you know what mine is? I'm a little older than you. The ship set ground on the shore of this enchanted desert isle with Gilligan,
the skipper too, a millionaire and his wife, a movie star,
the professor and Marianne here on Gilligan's Isle. That's the shit.
It was. Them niggas never
like
got off the island.
No.
Even the Globetrotters tried to get them niggas
yes,
off the island.
Yes.
They came and played a game and left the motherfuckers.
Yes, yes. That's crazy. When you look up and you see the Globetrotters playing, motherfucking niggas left us on the island. Metalark, fuck you!
Curly Neal!
You and Curly, fuck y'all!
It's called bloody. I got a little thing on my show, Arsenio, where it's called
the You Essence. Do news and everything.
Nigga, my shit is for real.
I see that. You got the Dick Van, this just happened, the Dick Van Dyke.
His car caught on fire.
Yeah, yeah, he took a picture and put it on Twitter. Dick Van Dyke,
is that the nigga from Ages Enough?
No, no, that's the other Van Dyke. Dick Van Dyke tripped over the ottoman at the beginning of ba ba da 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 ba da 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 ba da 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 da.
The Dick Van Dyke Show.
Yes, and Mary Tyler Moore.
Oh, this old ass nigga.
Yeah. You know what? The last time his name was in the paper, on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, they put his name on a star and they misspelled it. And I thought, he waited all his life. And then they misspell his name. And by the way, you would think in Hollywood, if there's one place where you would spell a name with the word Dick and Dyke in it, this would be the place. We misspelled Dick Van Dyke. As hard as he's worked all his life.
Oh, Dick Van Dyke.
But I guess he tweeted a picture of him slumped over at the wheel.
Was he getting head or he just was tired?
Yeah, he might have been in Divine Brown's neighborhood or something, trying to get his Hugh Grant on.
Divine Brown.
Oh, you remember her?
Yeah, I remember the bitch. She showed up at one of my parties at my house one night.
Oh, really?
Like, bitch, what are you doing here? Matter of fact, getting it back.
Yes.
Somebody needs your mouth. If I could work with anybody, I would want to work with.
Wow. It's weird because the first thing that came to my mind, and this, I'm going to tell this story just because it's somebody we love and respect, and I haven't had a chance to say this. But when I decided to come back to the talk show, I was at a friend of ours' house, Ron Burkle. Mm. Okay, so you know how we hang at Ron Burkle's house. It's like, that's another white man that let us in his crib.
Don't he? And we could take our shoes off and spend the night and everything.
Yeah, Ron Burkle on Ralph's, it's always fresh food up there.
Fresh.
You know?
You can steal, they won't say nothing. Yeah, I've been stealing candy out of Ralph's for years.
Yep, and when you get caught, you say, call Ron. Yeah, I'm shoplifting, call Ron. But we was at Ron's house, and you know how when Diddy gives a party, Diddy will have a mic during the whole party, you know, and he'll constantly be talking and doing things. So I'm talking to him, and it's me and him and some people standing around, and he says, I don't understand why you won't go back to the show. And I said, it's weird you say that, because it's been on me lately, man. It's not about paper. Mm-mm. I can go to a comedy club and get laughter. Mm-hmm. It's that specific vehicle. I miss my show. And Diddy did what Diddy will do. He grabbed a mic, and without saying anything, he said, yo, Arsenio coming back, y'all. The party right now is a celebration of Arsenio coming back. And so everybody, we started partying. And I was like, hey, man, what the fuck is a lot of people, you know? But what was real cool is Vivica Fox was standing here, and everybody's hanging around. But right here, in a bright shirt, the color of that shirt there, like a red or orange, it's Michael Jackson. And Michael's sitting there, and he's hanging out. And you know, if you hang out with Michael, Michael's different than people think he is. Michael's fun.
He's not that guy that y'all see on TV. Mm-hmm. He lets his hair down.
Yeah, he's
fun guy. Ooh, loves a fun time.
He's the one that smashed Brooke Shields back
now,
in the day.
Remember that old Blue Eyes? Remember Blue Lagoon? He knocked the bitch. The other nigga just swam in the water with him. That's all he did was swam with the bitch.
Michael
and cut.
Handled it.
He had the bitch. And Michael. He had the old bitch too. Yeah. Elizabeth Taylor. Yeah.
And I've heard Michael talk. People
old
don't
ancient
hear
pussy.
You gotta hear Michael say, she's
an antique good. Pussy.
Yes. He killed it. He killed it, shined it, and left it alone. Working with him again, you know. I just wish he was around so I could have him on the show, working with Mike again. And he was one of those people that was always, I can't believe that you don't want to come back to the show. And he was always, and now that he's gone, I wish I could just say, Mike, that night that Diddy said what he said, man, that set it off.
Church, preach, tabernacle.